Thank you very much, Pamela, for that kind introduction, and thank you for your years of raising awareness in the Latino community on issues like the Affordable Care Act and so many others. I'm happy to be here in Orlando for your 2016 annual conference, and I'm honored to speak to an organization that works every day to empower our communities in a city that recently taught us how powerful a community can be. This organization had some powerful words about the tragic shooting that took 49 lives just last month at the Pulse nightclub. We are saddened, but also strengthened by our unity. One of the places we saw the strength of that unity was the Orlando Regional Medical Center, just blocks away from the nightclub, in the place where many of the victims were cared for. One surgeon at ORMC told the Orlando Sentinel that every single time he called a fellow surgeon to rush to the ER, he got the same unequivocal answer: I will be right there. Nurses kept arriving, even those that weren't on call. And that's what a strong and resilient community does best. And that's the same resilience that we've seen in Baton Rouge, in Falcon Heights, and in Dallas. We come together for those who are hurt, we bind our wounds, and we heal together. When we come together, we can build a better future for us and for our children. And building a better future has always been NCLR's priority, and the priority of the hardworking affiliates across this country. And that's why I'm so excited to join you all today. I want to celebrate the accomplishments we've made together for the health of the Latino community. And I want to tell you how our progress depends on many of you. La comunidad, young and old, men and women, working together in your own neighborhoods and in your own communities. But first, I want to quickly touch on an issue that concerns the health of the Latino community, especially right here in Florida where we are today. A top public health focus for us right now is to reduce the risk of the Zika virus to pregnant women and women of childbearing age. Zika poses a particular risk to pregnant women because we know that it can cause severe birth defects called microcephaly. Right now, there are more than 5,200 cases of Zika in the United States and in the U.S. territories, and many of those are in Puerto Rico. The number continues to rise each week. We expect that local transmission of Zika by mosquitoes will occur here in the continental U.S. and Hawaii sometime this summer. And we're working diligently to respond. We're working with states and territories and local governments on steps that they can take to prevent, detect, and respond to Zika. We're sharing advice on the best ways to reduce the mosquito population, and we're working to improve diagnostic capacity or testing capacity and to keep the blood supply free of Zika. At the same time, we're also working to develop a vaccine and improve the test, the diagnostic test, so that people can get accurate results more quickly than they can right now. We're communicating health risks to the public, and our department is making sure that our outreach materials are culturally competent and linguistically appropriate. And we're working closely with trusted local messengers like Promotores de Salud. But we need your help, both here in the mainland and in Puerto Rico. Please spread the word about pregnant women and women of childbearing ages so they can protect themselves. Tell your community how to implement common mosquito prevention techniques. And you can find plenty of information online at cdc.gov/Zika, or for Spanish speakers, espanol.cdc.gov. And I hope you will all have a chance to join our great Surgeon General, Vivek Murthy, at the town hall on Zika later today. There are many tools that can help us fight health threats like Zika, but one of the most effective is a health system where people have health coverage. And fortunately, our nation took an enormous step forward for the health and safety of our communities when President Obama signed the Affordable Care Act into law. In the 6 years since the law passed, Latinos have made enormous gains in accessing health care coverage. In fact, 4.2 million Latino adults have gained health coverage thanks to the law. That's a remarkable 27% drop in the uninsured rate among Latinos. Nationwide, our rate of uninsurance is the lowest in our nation's history. 9 out of 10 of every American is covered today. That's unprecedented in our history, 9 out of 10. And coverage today is better than before. There are no longer annual or lifetime dollar limits on your coverage. Preventative services like screening for diabetes, well child visits, or diet counseling are available at no extra cost. And insurers can no longer keep someone from getting covered just because they have a pre-existing condition. That means millions of cancer survivors and people with chronic conditions are no longer barred from the insurance market. And earlier this year, we made clear through rulemaking that hospitals, insurers, and clinicians should help people understand their coverage and their care, even if English is not their first language. This is real progress. There's a father today who can dance at his daughter's quinceañera because his coverage helped him with knee surgery. There's a young Latina who can stay in school and be the first in her family to graduate because she got the counseling that she needed and is now on her way to college. There's a young man working a couple of entry-level jobs who can stay covered under his parents' health insurance until he turns 26, giving him a chance to build the skills he needs to get that promotion. Their progress, our progress as a nation, is thanks to you, both at the national level and on the ground. You hosted a national conference call with the entire affiliate network during our last open enrollment. You helped lead a radio tour for the Latino community, and NCLR has been a key player in our National Affordable Care Act Latino Coalition. But our progress also hinges on the work many of you have done right in your communities, the enrollment events you hosted in your own neighborhood, the times you sat down and help someone enroll face-to-face, the doors that you knocked on, and the pavement you walked on, every step you took on this journey with us. You're not just part of this historic progress we've made, you're the reason that we made it. And you knew I wouldn't come without an ask. There's more progress to be made. And one piece of unfinished business we have is that even though we have the Affordable Care Act, too many states have not chosen to expand Medicaid. And these states like Texas, Georgia, and Florida, states that many Latinos call home, want to make sure everybody knows, all the governors, all those states, my door is always open to those state leaders to make sure that they know I'm always ready to discuss ways that we can expand Medicaid. I'm eager to move forward on common ground, and I believe we have a lot of ground that we can cover and we can do it. And the Affordable Care Act wasn't just about getting people covered. It also gave us tools to build a better, healthier healthcare system, one that works for every American. We're working to find ways to deliver better care, spend our dollars more wisely, and keep our people healthier. To get there, we have a three-part strategy. First, change the way we pay so that we pay for the quality of care, not the quantity of services. Next, help improve care delivery by improving coordination and integration and promoting wellness and prevention. And finally, unlock healthcare data and information so that doctors have the information they need to make the best decisions and people are empowered to be active participants in their care. That's the future of healthcare. And that future is taking shape all around the country, probably right now in your own communities. Back in Washington, people sometimes talk about this thing called a lame duck. Somehow, they think that in the last few months of an administration, you don't have very much work. Well, I played basketball in high school, and my coach always taught me to play four quarters. You give it all till the moment of the last shot. That's our philosophy at HHS. We're on the court. We're still playing, and we're still playing with you. So, in fact, here's the ask. In just a few months, we have open enrollment again. And just like the past three, we'll be crossing the country to make sure more people in more communities get covered. And our planning for the next open enrollment started with a detailed and data-driven look at what worked in the past open enrollments and where we could improve and do better. And here are three things we've already announced that we're going to be doing this year. One, we're going to work closely with the IRS to reach out to the families who paid the fee for being uninsured and who claimed an exemption in 2015. We'll let them know that coverage is available and that tax credits can make it affordable. This is an outreach strategy that outside experts have recommended to us repeatedly and has worked well in Massachusetts. Second, data and testing has taught us what works for reaching different groups of consumers, and we're going to improve our systems so that we can act on those lessons. We've learned that sending an email with the right information at just the right time, usually a deadline, can make a significant difference in whether or not someone gets covered. And that's especially important for young people who are almost twice as likely as older consumers to enroll because of email. And finally, we learned that our greatest progress comes when we work together with outside partners in business like Lyft or advocates like NCLR and the nationwide network of affiliates. So together, we can do much more than if we try and go this alone. I know each of you all has a story that led you here, a person who inspired you to get involved, a moment that ignited a spark in you, some reason that you couldn't just sit idly by any longer. Gracialia Guzman recently shared her story with Progress Illinois. Her story starts in El Salvador, when her parents fled the turmoil there and they went to Los Angeles in the 1990s. Like many new American families, they made the best of their new life. But healthcare, too, often felt like a luxury that they just couldn't afford. And then one day, her grandfather fell ill. The doctors diagnosed him with a late-stage cancer. They lost him not too long after that. But she remembered that experience in that hospital, not knowing whether her grandfather was getting the best care, translating between her family and the doctors, the fear of losing a loved one, and the fear of not knowing how they would pay for all this care. Today, all of those experiences are bridges she uses to connect with others. Today, she works in the Chicago area to help Latino and other minority families get covered. She leads the Chicago Affordable Care Act Consortium, and she's an enrollment coordinator with the Patient Innovation Center. She understands that healthcare can be frightening and sometimes confusing. She also understands how important it is. And as she says now, quote, "There is no greater service than helping individuals gain access to healthcare. We want to see it happen." Thanks to you all, millions of Latinos have access to healthcare today, but there are still many more in your communities who don't know how to get the coverage they need. Be their bridge. Help them get covered. Help them get the care they need. Commit to that great service and help your communities be healthier. And look around this room, you're not making a commitment alone, because we are all strengthened by our unity. Thank you all for having me.